Hello my friends, this is Reid. Welcome to another modern video here on ChannelFireball.com. Today, for a change of pace, we're going to be mana screwing some people. This is Red-Green Ponza, or Red-Green Land Destruction. Ponza is an old-fashioned name for, red-based land destruction decks. But what I have in front of me is based on Andrew Wolber's deck. Andrew Wolber's is the player who recently sort of put this deck on the map. He won a StarCityGames.com Open and then also had a strong finish at Grand Prix Phoenix, 12-3 record. So he sort of showed that while this deck had existed for a long time, now maybe it's a real contender that people should be taking seriously. So I started with his deck list from Grand Prix Phoenix, just changed a small handful of cards. Part of the reason that I like this deck, I like the color combination, first of all. It is two-thirds of Jund, after all. But I think Blood Moon is a super strong card in Modern. Just invalidates a lot of decks and strategies, gives you free wins, which is something that you really should look for in a format as powerful and diverse as Modern. But I also am excited about Tireless Tracker, Lightning Bolt, Flame Slash, which is one of the changes that I made to Wilbur's deck. But there are some particular cards that I think are really well positioned in Modern, and this is a shell to be able to use them. So, I think this type of deck is going to excel against anyone that's weak to a Blood Moon with an ambitious mana base, naturally Tron and Valakut, stuff like that. I think it's going to be really strong against Control as well, as those decks do need their mana, and you have a high concentration of sort of sticky threats that can't be answered on a one-for-one basis. Bloodbraid Elf, Chandra, Tireless Tracker, those are all good examples. And then the sideboard, just pretty wide range of answer cards and things that are going to shore me up against fast aggro and decks that are attacking my life total, graveyard decks. So I don't know how this is going to go. It's really my first time playing this archetype in Modern, but I'm excited to run it through a video, and I hope you'll stay tuned. Hello, welcome back for round number one. I am on the draw. I have a really nice hand. I guess this is sort of the reason you want to play this deck, for the turn one accelerant, turn two land destruction type draws. Utopia Sprawl is the best one since it produces both colors of mana, pairs really well with Arbor Elf, and can't just get lightning bolted on turn one, so a little bit more reliable in that sense. You do want to be careful to put it on a basic forest when you can, rather than a stomping ground, because then you can't get Field of Ruined. All right, I'm up against Affinity, which should be a very tough matchup in game one. Potentially gets a little bit better after sideboard, but I'm expecting to be an underdog here and have to get a little bit lucky. Well-placed Anger of the Gods, for example. Okay. I was musing the other day that this deck would be a lot stronger if Pillage was legal. Pillage, red-red one, destroy target land or artifact. I think that would be a really nice effect in Modern, and since this deck doesn't really need the two damage off of Molten Rain, it would be an upgrade. Okay, so what can I do here? I suppose I can play Forest, Utopia Sprawl this again, and then cast either Molten Rain or Tireless Tracker. Tireless Tracker doesn't block here, so I think I just want to destroy the Blink Moth Nexus, but realistically, it's going to be very tough for me to win this game. I guess if I destroy the Blink Moth Nexus and then cascade into back-to-back Lightning Bolts or something like that, or just draw a Lightning Bolt. At least I get my opponent down to 18. Well, this is not so bad if I just take 6 damage and my opponent doesn't add anything. That's not so good. So I just got Galvanic Blasted down to 5, which means, yeah, I think the only way I could have won there is by just naturally drawing Lightning Bolt. But as it is, even if I Cascade into Lightning Bolt, I guess I can kill Signal Pest, and then if my opponent has just absolutely nothing, you know, 2 more Spires of Industry in hand, I could win. Yeah, might as well try it, right? Okay, so I should kill Signal Pest, though I don't think it really matters. Okay, I need my opponent to have no artifact and no Galvanic Blast. Okay, that's step one. Ah! All right, well, that's fine. I was expecting to lose game one, and after I bring in a couple ancient grudges, maybe you'll have a slightly better chance. Anger of the Gods, too. All right, so Kitchen Finks, Obstinate Baloth, Scavenging Ooze, these are options, though not particularly exciting options. Anger of the Gods, Ancient Grudge, and a Braid, those are slam dunks. And then let's see. I could trim on Birds of Paradise if I felt like I wanted more staying power, plus I'm bringing Anger of the Gods, which kills the birds. Blood Moon seems not the greatest. Same with, well, all of the land destruction seems like it's not the greatest. I could potentially trim one Tireless Tracker. Chandra, kind of bad, I think. In some way, I want every card that can kill a creature, but in other ways, this is just way too expensive for the job. So I think I will leave in the Birds of Paradise just to get to Pia and Kieran a little faster. So what are my best and worst cards? I think I don't want zero land destruction because killing those nexuses can be pretty effective. And in fact, maybe Blood Moon is just the best to get to shut off all the nexuses in one go. Don't mind Scavenging Ooze. So let's say I do want these. Maybe Blood Moon is fine. Something like two Blood Moon, two Stone Rain. Keep in mind, I'm still learning the deck, so this is not going to be super precise sideboarding, but this looks reasonable enough to me. Finks and Obstinate Baloth, generally good against aggro, but specifically not good against affinity since most of their threats, they're not ground attackers. It's like Etch Champion or flying creatures. Okay, so I get to go first here, which is great. And I have a slow hand, but I do have Anger of the Gods, but only two lands also. It's a bit dicey. If I don't hit my third land on time, this hand is completely awful. And even if I do hit my land, I'm pretty reliant on my opponent just randomly having a draw that plays into Anger of the Gods. So I think I'm gonna throw this one back. Boy, that's bad as well. Nothing, nothing, Stone Rain is not going to be good enough against Affinity. So I'm going to go to 5 here. Hope to have Ancient Grudge in my hand. Well, I don't have Ancient Grudge, but I have to keep. Scry to the bottom, and think the only way I win this game is if I draw Ancient Grudge or Anger of the Gods in my first two draw steps. Okay, Lightning Bolt's not bad, not a bad draw. Let me cast something, defend myself a little bit. Don't think this Ponza deck can really beat Etch Champion. Now, it's tempting to wait on the tireless tracker to try to get a clue right away, but I think I have to spend my mana, and it's not even 100% clear that my opponent would leave in Galvanic Blast, but certainly it worked out badly there. Yeah, this is getting a bit ugly. So I feel like I could have been dead this turn if my opponent had equipped the plating onto the Nexus and then just activated Blink Moth Nexus. Right, big draw. Nope. Well, that was a little anticlimactic, but starting off 0-1 against a pretty tough matchup. I'll see you for round two. Welcome back for round two. We're looking to get on track with modern red-green land destruction. Well, this is not a very land destruction-y hand, but it is a very good hand, and I'm happy to keep it. My opponent down to six cards. Down to five cards. All right, Swamp Fatal Push. So, still a lot of decks that I could be up against here. I suppose Jund is the most likely. My real choice here is whether to play Stomping Ground tapped or Wooded Foothills. I should play Wooded Foothills. Given my uncertainty, it's just so important for me if my opponent plays something like Dark Confidant on turn two that I can bolt it and then untap in Stone Rain. And my life total doesn't seem to be in quite as much jeopardy. Aha, so it's not Jund after all, it's probably Mardu Pyromancer. Now, I think I'm actually going to leave this Wooded Foothills uncracked because the combination of my opponent taking away the Stone Rain and the possibility of either player playing Blood Moon means I might want to get a second forest here. Sure. So I'm going to go ahead and bolt a spirit token. Untap, play Chandra. Well, actually, Molten Rain, does that change anything? It does not change anything. Just going to play Chandra and plus. And sort of getting into a race situation here looks fine as my opponent's already down to 13. Now 11. As expected, that's a Lingering Souls flashback. So with no cards that cost exactly 5 mana in my deck, I'm going to plus Chandra first before playing the land in case I hit Tireless Tracker. Okay, just a forest. But at least my opponent's down to 9 here. And Molten Rain should hit. Definitely want the 2 damage, so I'm not going after basic Swamp. I guess it just makes sense to get the Sacred Foundry. If I draw Stone Rain, it's kind of nice to kill the 2 black sources, but might as well cut my opponent on a color. Bloodbraid Elf would be amazing. Okay. So my opponent down to 6 from the fetch. We'll go to potentially 4 from Chandra plussing. Still not in range of Bloodbraid Bolt or Inferno Titan, but getting close. Wow, discards Terminate and Kolaghan's Command, so must have some good cards in hand. Now, I have Inferno Titan that I could hit with Chandra when I plus. I have 2 Inferno Titans and 3 Tireless Trackers. I feel like it's too important to be able to... Okay, well, compromise. Oh, no, if I can't fetch if I hit the Inferno Titan, so I'm just going to play the Forest and plus. It's too much of a disaster if I'm unable to cast Inferno Titan. It is a Utopia Sprawl, which I will not cast. I'll just take the 2 damage to my opponent, and I'll pass. And I'm actually losing this game. I need to top deck Inferno Titan, Bloodbraid Elf, something like that. Or I guess just 2 burn spells. Chandra didn't get me any real value, but I suppose she was still a 12-point life swing, which is not bad for 4 mana. Now I understand Terminate and Kolaghan's Command hit the bin specifically so that Bedlam Reveler could be cast for cheaper. This is getting pretty ugly. It's going to be embarrassing if I lose this game after my opponent mulliganed to 5 and I had Chandra in play for a few turns, but I have sort of just hit all lands. I hit a Tireless Tracker the one turn that I cast Chandra, and then that's the only real business card I've seen the whole game. Not really a business card, but I guess I can Wolf Run it. Sure. All right, so I'm looking for Bloodbraid into something, or in big trouble here. All right. So I can make two clues. Don't have enough mana to even hit two lightning bolts. I guess there's no reason to concede. I'll just play out the tracker. Well, pretty bad showing for red-green so far. Gotta feel like Anger of the Gods is great in this matchup. A Braid can kill Young Pyromancer only. Chandra's fine. Yeah, Chandra's fine. Obstinate Baloth and Scavenging Ooze both look okay. So does Kitchen Finks. Relic. Grafdigger's Cage stops the flashback on Lingering Souls and Faithless Looting, but it does not stop Bedlam Reveler or Kolaghan's Command, so I prefer the relics here. Oh, you know what? I have a correction from when I was discussing my deck earlier. I put a Flame Slash in my sideboard and mentioned that as a card I was excited to try out, but I think I had actually joined the league before adding that to my deck, so I don't have it in front of me right now. I don't have that Flame Slash. It might be okay if, against Bedlam Reveler and Young Pyromancer if I hit it, but Relic is even better. Anyway, what am I taking out? I don't think that a Mana Denial plan is so good here, since I'm playing against an opposing Blood Moon deck whose spells mostly cost 1 and 2 mana. But how good is Lightning Bolt? I have Anger of the Gods, and Lightning Bolt only really good against Young Pyromancer. There's usually pretty small number of Planeswalkers in this deck. So I could see maybe having only three bolts and play a Stone Rain instead. Do I want all 10 of my mana accelerants? I am raising my curve quite a bit, so I think the answer is yes. Okay, let's try this. I like this hand. Anger of the Gods a bit awkward in this hand, but still fine. Wow, again my opponent mulligans to 5, but they only needed 5 cards to beat me last time. Let's see if this one's different. Probably just going to take Lightning Bolt. No, it takes Anger. It's fine with me. Okay. Wow, so I can cast Bloodbraid Elf here. Look at that. I play Stomping Ground untapped. A Utopia Sprawl named Red. Tap for 2. Untap. Tap for 2. I like that Arbor Elf Utopia Sprawl combo, and that's a good Cascade. Pretty punishing second turn against an opponent who mulliganed to 5. Okay, now I'm feeling what this deck's all about. It's not really the land destruction that's been so exciting so far, but that was a great turn. Okay. Interesting. I don't think I care about playing End Cracking Relic in the same turn, so let's put it on the same forest. Start by cracking the relic. Definitely want to get rid of that lingering souls. Ooh, hello. Yep. I put it down to two, so I'm not sure how they get back into this. It's got to be like Dreadbore Chandra, Bolt, Bloodbraid, and then have some good draw steps from there. Okay. Well, that was pretty cool. That was a fun game. Let's see game three if I can beat an opponent who gets to keep seven cards. I didn't really learn much from that game that would make me change my sideboarding, so we'll go with it one more time. Again, my opponent mulligans, but this is a great hand for me. I have both a powerful answer card in Anger of the Gods and a powerful threat card in Tireless Tracker alongside my acceleration and multiple fetch lands. But what my draw isn't is resilient against discard spells. That has to be a freshly drawn Thoughtseize, I would imagine. My opponent takes away the tracker and no land drop. Yeah, I can see a little bit the play pattern of this deck. It's just amazing when you draw the right balance of mana and threats, but pretty big risk of flooding or just not having your third mana source. I think I'm going to crack one of my fetch lands at the end of the turn. Just trying to strike the right balance between deck thinning, but making sure I have enough juice if I draw Tireless Tracker. Also, it is possible my opponent could play a Blood Moon, in which case I want to be able to fetch a couple basic forests in response. Ooh, hello. I mean, I'm sure my opponent could kill the Finx, but pretty exciting nonetheless. What about these fetch lands? I'll crack one. Naturally, if my opponent was tapped out, I would crack the other fetch land as well, but I'm just sort of expecting the Finx to get bolted. Ooh, it does not get bolted. That's pretty exciting. Ah, Birds of Paradise. Could get the job done with Kessig Wolf Run. Sure. Ooh, two lingering souls in the graveyard. Big draw step for me here. Lightning Bolt, pretty bad, but I guess my opponent is at eight. And counting. Plus, if I draw Anger of the Gods, of which I have two remaining in the deck, that means I can kill all the souls and the Bedlam Reveler. Looks like my opponent is holding up instant speed removal for a possible Bloodbraid Elf. Doesn't want to just die out of nowhere to Bloodbraid Elf plus Wolf Run. My opponent down to six. That opens up new outs for me. Yep, bail off down. Definitely still keeping up instant speed removal. It's the only explanation, I think. All right. Feel like I'm not gonna play that because of Kolaghan's command. Now leaving back a spirit, what could that mean? That should be lethal. I don't think the Mardu deck plays any life gain, so seems like I might have just stolen this one. Whew, that was close. One and one. At one and one, I'm back for round number three here with Modern Ponza and a perfect, perfect, perfect hand. Interesting decision here, as I could play turn one Birds of Paradise, and then I can play turn two Utopia Sprawl and a three mana spell. But the downside is the Birds of Paradise could then get lightning bolted or fatal pushed, and I can't cast a three mana spell on turn two. So I think I'm going to take the safer route of Utopia Sprawl on my forest. No Aether Vial, no Aether Vial. Oh, that one can't even cast Aether Vial. All right, so Blood Moon usually locks out the humans deck. This is a pretty silly game. I guess my opponent could still draw Aether Vial to be back in it. But I think this is normally a moderately tough matchup, but you can definitely steal games like this with Blood Moon, as the humans deck usually only plays one basic land. I don't see any reason not to cast at least a couple of these land destruction spells. Maybe I'll save one in case my opponent does draw their basic. Okay. Well, that was silly. So, against humans, I think I just want everything that kills a creature. This is where that flame slash would be really valuable. And then, yeah, these creatures look fine as well. And what I'm less excited about, I still love the Blood Moons, but I'm less excited about Stone Rain and Molten Rain. I want all my cheap cards here. I want the oozes. I'd say probably Obstinate Baloth's the weakest of my top end cards, maybe Pia and Kirin. I like Chandra. I feel like that's she's ha so, a big part of how I'm going to win these games. Kind of feel like I need the trackers. What else am I cutting? could cut like one tracker and one Finks. Maybe Courser's the weakest. Maybe one tracker, one Finks. Finks, in a way, is my answer to a Champion of the Parish or Thalia's Lieutenant that just gets enormous because can't kill it with the red burn spells. So, but then again, it's bad with Anger of the Gods. Okay, I think I'm all right with this configuration. I don't think I want to cut any of these one-drop accelerants. It's too important to have one in my opening hand. Well, no turn two Blood Moon means I'm going to have to win this one the old-fashioned way, but it is a very good hand. So my opponent mulliganed to six and scryed to the top. I think I'm still gonna name. Well, could name green because I do have the Finks and the ooze. Sure. So I named green there. I mean, I guess that's taking away Lightning Bolt. Now I've drawn Birds of Paradise, so looks like I'm going to fetch for another forest, play Utopia Sprawl, naming red, and then play Birds of Paradise and Scavenging Ooze, and put myself in a position where I can cast Inferno Titan if I draw a land. I don't think there's much reason to split the Utopia Sprawls. It's better with Arbor Elf. There are some reasons, you know, if I want to divide my mana between an instant and a sorcery speed card, but I think the Arbor Elf consideration is more important. Ouch, this is a nice hand from the humans player. Oh, it's Meddling Mage, I thought. Well, I thought it was going to be Thalia's Lieutenant, but in a way, Meddling Mage is worse. Hopefully I just draw Anger of the Gods and make this nice and easy. Should be pretty simple here. I just have about three draw steps to find a card that removes a creature. And if not, I'm going to die in the air. Ooh. That speeds up the clock. Now I guess I only have two draw steps. Sure. I'll take it. Come on, something. Anger of the gods, lightning bolt. Nope. So if I would need three creatures to die. And then I chump block with Birds of Paradise. Well, Scavenging Ooze was kind of bad this game. Maybe I'll cut one of the oozes for another Finx or another Tracker. Let's go with another tracker. I'm on the play this time. I'm not as worried about a quick rushdown. More worried about like what happened in that game, drawing small number of specific threats that get answered with Freebooter and Meddling Mage. Would like to play first, and I like this hand, even though it has no removal spells. It's really nice. I love just when I have two lands and a mana accelerant. No better feeling. I think I need to keep the mountain in my hand so that next turn, if I draw Lightning Bolt, I can go Tracker, land, and have red mana open, as opposed to if I played the mountain this turn, I would have to tap the mountain and then have green open. So making your land drops on future turns is important to consider with Tireless Tracker. It's probably just going to name Lightning Bolt. That's what I would do. Yeah, name's Lightning Bolt. think my play this turn is Bloodbraid Elf. Anything but Lightning Bolt. Ooh, another tracker. This is pretty nice. And now, do I swing with... Yeah, I think I'm... At this point, I'm so far ahead in resources that I'm willing to trade pretty much any one-for-one trade. Normally, trading Tireless Tracker for, you know, pretty much any creature would be a bad idea, but I feel like I just need the game to not go at a super accelerated rate, and then I'll win for sure based on having the two Tireless Trackers and all these clue tokens. Plus, of course, it does free up Lightning Bolt as an important card that I can draw into. Here I'm taking potentially 5 damage in the air. 5 damage in the air. So I need to draw into an answer to that pretty quickly. And actually, it's hard to kill a 4 toughness creature for my deck. I might need to double team it or find PN Kirin Nalar. Okay, Courser of Krufix. I like that a lot. What order should I do things in here? Still don't think I'm in a position to race, even though the trackers can get pretty big pretty fast. Probably in a position where every life point matters, so let's play the Courser. More trackers, huh? Let's play a forest from my hand. Attack with Tireless Tracker. Crack a clue. And just hope I don't get killed in the air too fast. Cracking Horizon Canopy, a good sign. Dark Confidant, interesting. Reclamation Sage, my clue to... Oh, my Courser! Oh, I thought it was going to kill my clue token, but Courser is an enchantment. Jeez. What's the move here? I'm deadly afraid of losing even single points of life here. I mean, just on the board, fetching will change the clock by a turn. So I think what I have to do is... Maybe I just attack with Tireless Tracker before anything else. And if my opponent double blocks, I'm definitely okay with that. I didn't crack pre-combat there because I might need Arbor Elf as a blocker. Ooh, that's another Mantis Rider, which means that I am dead next turn if I don't find anything. However, it did deal 3 damage to my opponent, so they might also be in chump lock mode now. Lightning bolts can almost just go to the face. Okay, so there's one card in hand and a vial on 3, so I have to be prepared for Mantis Rider or Reflector Mage. I think Reflector Mage would have already hit the battlefield if my opponent had it, so would Mantis Rider. So I think I'm just going to take this at face value and block. In the obvious way, which would be Bloodbraid Elf on Lieutenant, Tracker on Reclamation Sage. I mean, could it be another? Could be like Vithian Renegades or something, which would pump the Lieutenant at instant speed. Whatever, I'm not too worried about it. I guess if it's Kessig Malcontents, I'm just dead anyway. Don't have to worry too much about that. Ah, oh, it is Reflector Mage. So that's going to bounce my Arbor Elf. A little late on that Blood Moon. I guess it wouldn't have done that much against Vile anyway. So I can crack one clue in case it is Pia and Kieran Nalar. Or I can cast Bloodbraid Elf and hitting Scavenging Ooze still doesn't allow me to survive. Hitting Birds of Paradise. Actually, hitting Birds of Paradise does change things. That would give me 4 blockers. No, still not good enough. So I think the move is Catacombs. Crack it for a forest. Sack a clue. And I have to hit Pia and Kieran Nalar. Or Anger of the Gods would make my attack lethal. If I don't hit one of those two cards, then I have to Bloodbraid into Anger of the Gods. And I don't think there's any other combinations of cards that I can find. I guess if I crack the first clue and it's Lightning Bolt, then I could crack a second clue and it maybe be Lightning Bolt again. And I'm just trying to think about if the deck thinning on Verdant Catacombs matters. The deck thinning definitely matters. I'm trying to think if the life loss can matter. I don't think there's any way. Yeah, like if I hit Kitchen Finks, still not good enough. So yeah, here we go. See if I'm forgetting anything. Chandra kills the big Mantis Rider. Doesn't help. We're looking at Anger or Pia and Kieran, or maybe Double Bolt or like Bird Bolt. Pretty thin, but not completely dead. Here we go. Another Blood Moon. So now I have to Bloodbraid and hope to hit Anger. That's it. That's the only out. Come on, Anger of the Gods. Man. All I draw is all Blood Moons on the final crucial turn of the game. Might as well attack. Hope my opponent blocks in a weird way and then dies to Confidant. That was a close match. That was a fun match, too. I was doing well with the trackers, but a definite lack of interactive spells that to draw into, and the 4-power Mantis Riders pretty tough. At any rate, I'll see you for round 4. Hello, welcome back for round number 4 with red-green Ponza in Modern. I'm on the draw, but with a very good hand. My opponent on the play, mulligans to 6, scries to the bottom. Looks like I'm up against Hollow One. Probably a tough matchup for me. All right. This is 3 modes of collective brutality. Nice. Good turn. So my play is just Arbor Elf and a tapped land. And I hope my opponent doesn't have a Delve creature or a Goblin Lore or something like that to keep the wheels turning. I guess it has to be something better than a Goblin Lore, because that's what my opponent discarded, so. Yep, there's Gurmag Angler. It's going to be a tough one. Guess I'm going to try to block and bolt something. Block and bolt the Angler, then if I draw land, I can make a 4-3 tracker that trades with Hollow One. Okay. That buys me some time and allows me to produce multiple blockers to deal with the menace creature. Alright, so Pia and Thopter on Flameblade Adept is a pretty easy block. And then with just one card in my opponent's hand, I think I'm actually going to block the Bloodghast. Can't return it too many times. So in other words, I'm making the judgment call that putting the Bloodghast in the graveyard is going to be worth four damage or more in the long run compared to just jumping the Hollow One and letting the Bloodghast stay in play. Utopia Sprawl is a nice draw with the Arbor Elf. So I think I will make the play of Tireless Tracker and Crack Clue. Drawing land would be perfect. Oh, that's great. And do I crack right away? I guess I crack right away. So hopefully my opponent doesn't have a lightning bolt or anything too devastating here. So if I can actually trade off against the Hollow One, I might have stabilized. I left the Thopter back just in case. I mean, even a land brings the Bloodghast, which I'll want to block again. I could get greedy and try to make the tracker big enough over the long run, but I think this is a safer play. Seven mana, I guess I will start with Bloodbraid Elf. And it's Utopia Sprawl. I could pass with the intent to triple block the Tasigur. I'm just trying to judge how powerful Stone Raining is here. I think it's not that important. Just having extra blockers and cracking a couple clues sounds a little better. I'm going to try this. Just bank on drawing into something with the clue tokens. If the first token gives me a bolt, that would be amazing. The main way I could have played this game differently was to not trade off my tireless trackers, like use other chump blockers or just let my life total go even lower in order to keep a tracker on the battlefield. I think I might be overestimating how easy it is to win after drawing like two or three extra cards with this deck. I'm used to Jund, where just being up a couple of cards, you usually leverage into a win. But because this deck has a higher concentration of mana and some situational cards that aren't necessarily good to draw into later, like these Stone Rains, I might need to be emphasizing keeping the trackers in play a little bit more. Well, I do get some good weapons off the sideboard. All of these, I think I'll bring one grudge, one abraid. I mean, I can just bring in my whole sideboard here, to be honest. And cut all the land destruction. Lightning Bolt is not the best. Chandra is also not the best. I think I'm going to go with this configuration. Just going to get these relics out as quickly as possible. Oof, no hollow one. That's nice. That's good news. I think I'm just going to play a tapped land. I don't really care that much about cracking a relic this turn. Note that you can't, I don't get priority here, so I wouldn't, I could, even having one untapped land here, I could respond to the blood gas triggers by cracking a relic, but then my opponent could just fetch. So if I could have had two untapped lands, it would have been maybe helpful, and I could have played around this similar scenario, but with a non-fetch land. So maybe it was worth it to play an untapped land that turn. Tricky with the lightning bolts against the lightning bolts and the relics against the blood ghasts and the fetch land. I'm gonna just pass the turn and sort of pick my spot here, rather than try to rush things. Now I think I'm going to go bolt, bolt, crack relic. Why would my opponent fetch a basic swamp end of turn? And of course I draw Anger of the Gods, which would have been the perfect answer if those blood ghasts had still been in play. Alright, I'm going to crack my relic again because there's a Faithless Looting and I want to play around Delve Creature. Yep. That card alone might be enough to pull the trigger on Anger of the Gods. That definitely is enough. Sure. So pretty sure my opponent's going to have Terminator Dreadbore for the Inferno Titan, or else it's going to be game. Okay, on to game three. I think I drew pretty well that game with a double relic and a nice mix of lands curving into a super powerful Inferno Titan. I am happy with how I've improved after sideboard. I drew both bolts that game and they were kind of nice when pairing with the relics or the cage to take out those persistent threats. Overall, I think I like what I have here, and I'm not going to change anything. The dream is discarding Obstinate Baeloth against Burning Inquiry. Good hand. No graveyard hate, but Kitchen Finks can buy a lot of time, and this hand has pretty realistic potential to get to Inferno Titan. Whew. Well, that changed my hand. My opponent also discarded their Hollow One, so it could be worse. It's a Bloodghast. I think I just don't want to get greedy and I want to play the Cage right away. Unfortunately, Cage makes my Kitchen Finks worse, but it's going to do a lot more damage to my opponent than to me. There's already a Bloodghast in the graveyard. Faithless Looting discards Flamewake Phoenix and Burning Inquiry. Tap one mana for Hollow One. This time I split him up, just if I draw an Arbor Elf, I'm going to have as much mana as I need, and might as well hedge a little bit against the super niche possibility of my opponent having Molten Rain. Oh no! Oh no! Wow. Engineer Explosives kills four permanents. And now the floodgates are open for those cards to start coming back from the graveyard. Wow. All I can do is play either a bird or a Finx. I guess it's going to be the Finx. Yeah, that Engineer Explosive just single-handedly won my opponent the game. Goblin Lord discards another Explosives and two Big Game Hunters. Here comes Bloodghast and Phoenix. Still a Faithless Looting in the graveyard. I have to worry about. I guess I'll just take the damage for the first time. Cycle a couple of Street Wraiths. Yeah, I'm gonna try to double block the hollow one. Might not work if my opponent is lightning bolt, but that's not the worst case scenario anyway. It's not the end of the world. Going to try double blocking yet again. This time it works. Well, let's start with Pia and Kieran. Yeah, let's start with Pia and Kieran. My opponent just cast Faithless Looting and discarded two hollow ones, so that means they have something in their hand that's better than a free 4/4. Given that I am having trouble just beating the board, that's definitely bad news for me. I think it's just a lightning bolt, in which case I'm dead. Man, if not for that engineered explosives, that was another close, fun match. I'll be back for round five. Hello, welcome back for the fifth and final match with Red Green Ponza. My record is a fairly disappointing 1-3. However, two of those matches were really, really close, where maybe some potential changes to the way I played or the way I constructed my deck, or just, the way the cards came off the top could have tipped the scales in my favor. That was against humans in round three and hollow one in round four. But at any rate, here I am against a turn zero ley line of sanctity, probably boggles, which I don't think I can beat boggles with this deck. All right, so if I'm going to face down a Spirit Dancer or a Dryad Arbor, I want access to Lightning Bolt. No, it's not Boggles. Mistveil Plains. Activate this ability only if you control two or more white permanents. Put target card from your graveyard on the bottom of your library. So probably like Squadron Hawk pair with Mistveil Plains. But clearly this is a home brew, so I won't jump to any conclusions. Well, as long as I'm being a land destruction deck, I think I'm just gonna double bolt that mana producing wall. There's a Dryad Arbor. Which one should I Molten Rain? I think I'm gonna get the Temple Garden. Courser is definitely going to be annoying for this deck to beat. I'm going to play Bloodbraid Elf, even though it's tempting to get the tracker down before I make my land drop. I get a tracker out of the deal anyway. Courser already generating value. Idyllic Tutor on the top. Search for an enchantment card, reveal it, put it in your hand. Looks like that's going to get shuffled away as Idyllic Tutor searches for worship. Okay. Multiple Dryad Arbors, I guess, to go with worship. It's just a worship deck. Sapseep Forest lets you gain one life. All right, so there's worship. There's a forest off the top. To cast Blood Moon and untap a Stomping Ground in response. So under a Blood Moon, Dryad Arbor should be a 1/1 creature that does not tap for mana. I could bolt my opponent, but that won't be lethal because of the worship. There's another Dryad Arbor. All right. I don't need to bolt anything just yet. Oh, I can't target my opponent, so 1/1/1 is fine. Then hopefully next turn, if I can attack with Inferno Titan, then I can finish off the Courser with a Lightning Bolt. Of course, my opponent's gonna be playing another 4-toughness creature in Overgrown Battlement. But eventually the Inferno Titan should be able to fight through, especially since my opponent can't really cast spells under the Blood Moon. I want to kill the Overgrown Battlement so my opponent can't play that The name of the card escapes me, but it's triple green and white and two colorless. Other permanents you control have hexproof. If that card came down, I think I would be locked out of the game. So I just need to wait till I find another burn spell that I can finish off the courser and win the game. Also, any land lets me draw two extra cards, so I kind of like my position here. I just have to draw something. That Sylvan Caryatid might be effectively lethal, so I need to draw something here. Oh man, this is going to be a frustrating way to lose. Maybe I can deck my opponent. But I have no way to destroy Worship in my deck. And I have no way to kill a hexproof creature in my deck. If I can kill everything else my opponent plays, so I can afford to draw two more cards, I believe. This is going to be a long, boring game. Unless you're an extremely dedicated fan, you might want to fast forward in the video about 5 or 15 minutes to see what the result is. My opponent here plays Privileged Position, so now I fully can't kill anything, but I still am going to make my opponent kill me. So I can't crack any more clues or play any more lands off the top. So I'm effectively just going to be F6-ing every turn. And it's on my opponent to produce a flying creature. I did turn off the Mistveil Plains with my Blood Moons. I guess the Noble Hierarchs now unlock white spells, so probably my opponent will find something eventually. I'm going to keep playing. Don't necessarily expect you to keep watching this portion of the video. Definitely feel free to skip ahead. I'll be sure to narrate what happened in this game. If my opponent could find a win condition, if I wind up decking my opponent, if one of us runs out of time. I don't know how the game's going to end, but it's not going to be me winning with damage. I can't destroy privileged position, which means I can never target any of my opponent's other permanents. Heroic intervention, permanents you control gain hexproof indestructible, doesn't really matter. I guess if my opponent can pair that with a Wrath of God, that would be very good. My opponent conceded. Conceded. No way to get through my army of ground blockers. So that's that. I guess the Blood Moon shuts off Westvale Abbey and Mistvale Plains as win conditions. So there you have it. All right. Well, I also don't have any way to destroy an enchantment on my sideboard. I don't know if that's necessarily good deck building. I can Anger of the Gods away Sylvan Caryatid. I don't know. I'm going to bring in this Chandra. Lightning Bolt's not that exciting, though my opponent did have Noble Hierarch and Dryad Arbor. Pia and Kirin Nalar, not that exciting. I think I'll do like one Anger of the Gods just to be able to beat Sylvan Caryatid if I need to. And Lightning Bolt seems pretty good against the mana guys. Yeah, I guess I'm going to try this. Sand is slow, but it is pretty good. I think I'm going to mulligan to 6. That's better. So if you did skip ahead, what happened was we played a few turns and my opponent conceded, seeing that I wasn't going to play any more, draw any more cards and had more cards in my library. I guess my opponent just could not win through my ground blockers and also couldn't use their win conditions of Mistvale Plains and Westvale Abbey underneath the Blood Moon. So that was that. A good lesson about always making your opponent actually kill you, because I was locked out of the game, but turns out my opponent was locked out as well. So here comes Idyllic Tutor for Nevermore. It's going to be hard to cast when I bolt your Noble Hierarch. So I cast Blood Moon, my opponent will fetch a Plains in response. No, no fetch. I think my opponent's going to have a hard time. I don't really have to worry about board sweepers with no white mana. Inferno Titan can come down this turn if I would like, but let's think about... I have access to 6 mana. I think I just Stone Rain a forest, attack for 6, and then Bloodbraid Elf should be lethal next turn. All right, there you have it. Well, a little bit of an oddball matchup in the final round. My record overall is 2-3, which is a bad record, but like I said, two of the matches were quite close, and I do think this deck has a few cool things going for it, although the, Stone Rain, Molten Rain U plan, it's not great against the all of the decks that people are bringing in Modern, so you have to be prepared to change your deck after sideboarding or lean on different elements in different matchups. Hope you enjoyed the video. Remember, you can always subscribe by clicking down below, and I'll see you next time.